Greetings from Indian Medical Association. I am Dr. N.V. Kamath, Principal Advisor, Indian Medical Association. Welcome to our weekly show, where we discuss one particular issue every Thursday between 3 to 4 p.m. in association with our digital partner Library and web partner eBuddy Nexus. Today's topic is little different from our regular medical topics. As you all know that yesterday was Karwa Chauth and it was a big festival mostly in the northern part of India, where the married women observe fast and they celebrate for the benefit of their husbands. And coinciding with this, so we have chosen a topic which is concerned with the Hindu woman, and that is rights of the Hindu women in inheritance and succession. And today we have three experts. Shri Rahul Gupta, he is a senior advocate of Delhi High Court and Supreme Court of India, and he is practicing the law since 1989, and he is also our advocate in our panel in Indian Medical Association. We have Ms. Ira Gupta. She is a practicing advocate in Delhi High Court as well as Supreme Court of India, and advocate Shekhar Gupta, who is also practicing in Delhi High Court and Supreme Court of India. So we'll start our discussion with Shri Rahul Gupta ji. So what is the significance of this particular act, particular topic, that is rights of Hindu women in inheritance and succession, as far as our Hindu women are concerned?
See, Dr. Kamath, as you have very rightly started by linking our subject today with yesterday's festival of Karwa Chauth, and the reason why we have chosen this subject today, because this subject is of general public importance. Because we all live in families, whether we are doctors, we are lawyers, we are in any other business, we are all living in families. And in families, we have female members like our mothers, sisters, daughters, and wives. So for a long time, we have observed by our experience as a practicing lawyer that there have been discrimination between the male legal heirs and female legal heirs with respect to their rights of inheritance and succession in the properties of their family.
That is because we have the patriarchal system.
Exactly.
Where the women do not have much say.
Yes. So unless the Hindu, before the Hindu law was codified for the first time by enactment of Hindu Succession Act 1956, which came into effect from 17th June 1956, there were only customary laws depending upon the regions, depending upon the caste, and women were not given any rights to own and control in the properties. They were discriminated vis-a-vis a male member, like a son. They were not given any rights by birth. And the only rights what they were given and what were accepted were rights of sustenance and rights of maintenance. So for a long number of years, the women have been discriminated in so far as their rights of inheritance are concerned. Broadly, if we look at the properties in a family, there are two categories of properties. Properties are joint Hindu family properties, which are described and understood as ancestral properties, which come through ancestors and from more than one generation. Then there are properties which are self-owned by an ancestor, self-acquired. So broadly, these are the two categories of properties. So before Hindu Succession Act came in the year 1956, the Hindu women rights to own properties were not recognized and they were not codified.
When did this act came into existence?
This act came into existence on 17th June 1956. So Hindu Succession Act, when it came in 1956, for the first time the rights of women to own and control the property were recognized. So now after the coming into force of Hindu Succession Act, the women were accepted as class 1 legal heir on the death of their father, on the death of their husband, and they will get share in the properties left by their husband or their father. But these properties were the self-acquired properties. They were not the joint Hindu family properties. They were not the ancestral properties. So even after coming into force of Hindu Succession Act 1956, the Hindu women were still not included in the joint Hindu family properties, and they were not given a right to ask for partition and to get a share in the Hindu joint family properties. So from 1956 till 2005, the position continued like this. And only in the year 2005 that our legislature, on the basis of reports submitted by the Law Commission, they found that to give equal rights to the women and to give them equal status as that of a son, it was necessary to amend Hindu Succession Act 1956. And by the amendment in the year 2005, the women were given rights in the joint Hindu family properties also, equal to that of a son. So for the first time it happened in the history of laws that a woman can now become a co-partner by her birth in the family.
So when this came in 2005?
This came from 9th September 2005. So now the current position is that a woman like a son, a daughter like a son, has equal status both in respect of joint Hindu family properties and self-acquired properties. Now a daughter and a son, they are both equal and they are part of the co-partnery as earlier only son used to be. So with the coming into force of the new Hindu Succession Act in the year 2005, the daughter and the son, they have been brought at the same platform. Another very important aspect is that women, to become aware and to understand their rights, they must know that now with the new act of 2005, they have been given rights in the joint Hindu family properties also, and they have a right to claim their share equal to that of a son. At the same time, Hindu women can also make their own will, they can execute their will that they could do earlier also, and now also they can make their will in respect of their own self properties and also in respect of their share in the joint Hindu family properties. And now there are procedures where the wills can be registered in the offices of the competent sub-registrars, and the execution of the will can be videographed before the sub-registrar. This is very important step, because many times what we have observed that cases relating to proof of validity and genuineness of will, they keep pending in the courts for long number of years, because those legal heirs who are objecting against the will, they delay the matters for long number of years, and lot of harassment is caused to the person on whom the property has devolved. So in the year 2009, we had a judgment from our Delhi High Court where some directions were issued by the Honorable High Court to the government of NCT of Delhi and to the concerned authorities that they must start the procedure of videographing and digital recording of the execution of the will, and the sub-registrar should put some questions to the executor of the will and to the attesting witnesses to confirm that the intentions of the testator, who is the executor of the will, they are bona fide and the execution of the will is valid, and he is doing it in a with his all mind and wisdom, in his own wisdom and mind he is doing it, and there is no influence upon the executor and there is no kind of influence upon the witnesses.
But what happens to those cases where the death of the parents have has happened before 2005?
Yes.
And the girl wants to claim.
Very right.
Is it possible?
It is a very relevant question that you have put, Dr. Kamal, because there had been for a long time controversy, and there had been different legal judgments, there had been different position of law, because some judgments had said that the death of the father, even if it has taken place before 2005, but after the commencement of the Amendment Act, the daughters shall have the right in the properties of the father, which he was holding as joint Hindu family properties. But now the last word has come from the Supreme Court in the judgment delivered last year in 2015, where it has been now held that the death of the father must take place after the coming into force of the Amendment Act 2005, and then only the daughter shall be entitled to claim her share in the property on the basis of the amendments which have been made in the year 2005. So earlier there was some contradiction between the judgments of various high courts in our country, but now this ratio of law has been laid down and put at rest.
So they are not, it is not applicable from the back date, retrospective.
Yes, it is prospective.
It is prospective.
The law, the amended law is prospective now, and the death should take place after the coming into force of the Amendment Act on 9th of September 2005. And may I now request my colleague Shekhar Gupta to give his views on this subject.
Thank you very much, sir. Just one point I would like to add, that women can always claim their share in the self-acquired property of their father. It has nothing to do with the death either before 2005 or after 2005. Because once the property belongs to father or mother, then the Hindu Succession Act 1956, as it was originally in the statute book until date, shall be applicable to the self-acquired property of the father and mother. And the property shall devolve upon the class 1 legal heirs in case of a male Hindu as per section 8 of Hindu Succession Act, and in case of a female, like mother expires, then also the devolution shall take place as per section 15 of Hindu Succession Act. So this controversy that death take place prior to the 2005 or post 2005 shall be subject matter of the joint Hindu family property, which are ancestors in nature.
Correct. You are absolutely right, Shikhar. In so far as self-owned properties are concerned, they are governed by the provisions of Hindu Succession Act 1956. And in case the male dies, in case of a death of a male member of a family, the properties devolve upon the legal heirs, which are classified in class 1 in the schedule in the Hindu Succession Act. And similarly, if a female dies, then also her properties devolve upon the legal heirs as mentioned in the said act. So the amendment of 2005 was only in respect of joint Hindu family properties, the ancestral properties, the properties which have come in the hands of a male Hindu from the previous generation, and he has not himself acquired and earned those properties. So the amendments were only in respect of Hindu joint family properties, which are commonly called ancestral properties, and there the death of the father must be after 2005 Amendment Act, and then the daughter shall have right in those properties.
One more thing I would like to add. This entire mechanism is given in Section 6 of the 2005 Amendment Act, which is now Section 6 Hindu Succession Act 1956. There is one instance also where the daughters, the female co-partners, cannot claim any right in the property if it is being satisfied to the court that prior to the death the partition has taken place. If the property in which a daughter is claiming her right, if it is proved that the partition has already been taken place, in that case she cannot take the property, she cannot claim any right. But the partition should be one in writing. It should be by a registered document or by a decree of court. So the other legal heirs cannot say, in absence of these three things, that is a registered document in writing and a court decree or award of an arbitrator, that look, the partition has already been taken place and now you get out, you don't have any right. For that they have to satisfy the requirement of the section that the partition has taken place by a registered document or by a decree of court or by an award of arbitrator.
I would like to add one thing.
Ah, yeah.
In cases, whether in before 2005 amendment or after 2005 amendment, in case of self-acquired property, the father can always will out his property.
Sure.
And this, whether the daughter gets any share or not, will happen only in cases when he dies interstate.
Absolutely.
And he does not will it out.
Correct. Because Hindu Succession Act only provides for interstate succession.
Yes.
Because if there is a will existing left by the father, then the matter shall be governed by the provisions of Indian Succession Act.
Yes, sir.
And then it will be decided on the basis of the will who will inherit the property. Because whether you are a male or a female Hindu, you have your independent rights to execute your will and give your property to whomsoever you want. If that property is your self-acquired and self-owned property, that right is duly recognized in Section 30 of Hindu Succession Act 1956. So most of the time, the disputes what arise between the family members are in respect of joint Hindu family properties. Because in so far as self-acquired properties are concerned, there are no complexities, because it is well defined in Hindu Succession Act that how the property will devolve upon the legal heirs if a male Hindu dies or a female Hindu dies in case of self-acquired properties. So most of the time, the legal disputes which have been filed in the courts and which have been pending in the courts for adjudication, they generally are in respect of joint Hindu family properties, the ancestral properties, and it has been those properties where the women had earlier not been given any right to share, and now after the Amendment Act 2005, that the women have been given rights equal to that of a son in ancestral properties.
But if the parents, if the father makes a will,
yes,
that this much portion, this percentage goes to son and this much for the daughter.
Correct.
So will this new amendment will have a bearing on that?
See. The will is in respect of self-acquired property.
Okay.
And if the father has given some share to a son and some share to the daughter,
okay,
then in that case the son and the daughter shall, after the death of their father, mutually divide the property between them. And if they are not able to mutually and amicably do it, then they may have to go to the court for seeking partition of that property under the will of their father. And if the will is in respect of the ancestral property, then accordingly it will be governed under the Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005. Okay. And the death of the father then must take place after 2005.
Now, if the death is taken place after 2005,
yes,
and the will is contradicting the provisions under this amendment, so have we
then the will will not prevail.
Will not prevail.
Okay. Because will can only be in respect of any property, any rights, any share, what you have
acquired
in law, what you have acquired correctly in law. Okay. If you have made a wrong will, if you have made a will of a property in which you did not have any right, then that will is not enforceable and it cannot give rights to the legal heirs.
That means the importance of the will become less and less,
yes,
after the coming of this amendment of the amendments.
No, that may not be right to say. Will hold its own position in law. Whether the will is in respect of joint Hindu family property share or it is in respect of self-owned property, will have its own status in law. So far as the amendment is concerned, the amendment has basically given rights to the Hindu women, particularly daughter.
No, I want to make it clear.
Yes.
Suppose the person is having 100 acres of land, and he has one son and one daughter.
Yes.
And it should be 50-50.
Right.
50 for son and 50 for the daughter.
Okay.
But in the will, he writes 80 acres for the son and 20 for the daughters.
Correct.
So, how it is going to...
No, then in that case, will prevail. If the will is found to be valid and genuine,
okay,
in the court,
okay,
then 80% will go to the son and 20% will go to the daughter.
Okay, okay.
And if these 100 acres belong to the father in his own independent capacity, as his own property, then he had all the rights to give 80 acres to the son and 20 acres to the daughter.
Okay.
There cannot be any dispute on that.
There is no dispute on this.
No.
But even if there is injustice done to the daughter by the father?
No, this will not be a case of injustice.
Okay.
Because father has all the rights to give his property to any person he likes. He may not give it to his son and daughter, and he may give it to his brother.
This is in relation to the self-acquired.
This is in respect to the self-acquired
property. But properties. if it was an inherited property?
If it is inherited property, then the father can, by will, give only his share,
okay,
in that joint Hindu family property.
Okay. Suppose he has his share 100 acres. So he has one daughter and one son.
Correct.
And again in this case he makes 80-20.
Then also it will be the same position.
Okay.
If a father has 100 acres of land as a share in a joint Hindu family property,
okay,
then he can make a will of that 100 acres,
okay,
in whatever manner that he likes.
Okay, okay.
And he can give whatever number of acres to his son or to his daughter or to any third person who may not be related to him, but only in respect of his share in the joint Hindu family property.
Not the entire property.
Not for the share of the other people in the joint Hindu family property. Because in a joint Hindu family property there are four degrees of generation.
Yeah, other people.
There is a father, there is a son, there is a grandson, there is a great grandson, and now daughters are also included. So all the daughters, all the sons, all the grandsons from the son and from the daughter, they would all be part of the joint Hindu family property now.
But that means that in both the cases, the will of the father will prevail.
Oh yes.
Upon the law,
yes,
which is existence.
Will of the father will prevail,
okay,
if that will has been validly executed, if that will has been genuinely executed, If father has signed the will, it is attested by the attesting witnesses, because under the Indian Succession Act, there is a complete procedure and mechanism how a will has to be executed. So it is necessary that will must be signed by the testator, who is the executor of the will. Then it has to be compulsorily attested by minimum two attesting witnesses. And when it is proved in the court of law, then at least one of the attesting witnesses has to appear in the witness box and prove that the will was executed before him and he had signed on the will as an attesting witness.
No, but I just want to ask Ira, as a Hindu woman, how do you feel, how far you have achieved in the, your rights Hindu Succession Act and its amendment.
Very relevant.
Because in both the cases, the will of your father is prevailing and not the rules or its amendments.
And before Ira speaks, let me also tell you, she has lot of ancestral and paternal properties and her father's properties also. So she would be the most suitable person to understand this law and answer it.
Thank you, sir. So, yes, sir, the will obviously vitiates or diminishes our right over this prevailing law. But still, at least now we have a share in the property. Earlier there used to be like sir said, I have an ancestral property. So my bua, my father's sister, she never had a share in that ancestral property. So she cannot even claim it also. But now after this 2005, she has got a share in our ancestral property. Even now I also have a share in that property. So now it's a little difficult for my father, for my grandfather to will out the property and to give more share to their son as compared to us. So even I think fathers are now taking care of their daughters also, and they are treating their daughters equally with their son. So I don't think this, unless and until, yes, if somebody has got some wishes that I don't want to give the share to my daughter or to my son, that is a different thing. But I think fathers, mothers, grandfathers, grandmothers, they all are taking care of this, that everybody should get an equal share. And anyways, now daughters are taking care of their parents more than sons.
No, but what I am telling is that in spite of all these acts and the amendments, again, what is prevailing is the will of your parents.
No, it is not just the will.
I just want to add and clarify. Will has nothing to do with this subject.
Okay.
The moment a girl is born, she became a shareholder in the property.
Okay.
Suppose, first of all, for the application of Section 6 of Hindu Amendment Succession Act, there should be a property which is ancestral property. Once the property is an ancestral property, and suppose there are four persons before a girl is taking birth, like father and three sons, all the four persons are equally owner of that property. In ancestral property, in the case of ancestral property, you became owner not by purchasing but by just taking birth on this earth, on this planet. So when the property was in the hand of father, when his father must be alive, then they two have 50% share each in that property. In case of ancestral property, with the death, the share increases, and with the birth, it decreases. So when the grandfather must have died, the share of father increased to 100%. Then one son born out, then they become one half. Another son born out, they become one third. And suppose third, a daughter is born, then they become one fourth. So now the daughter is automatically, by way of this Section 6 amended provision of the Hindu Succession Act, she became one fourth owner of the ancestral property. Now nobody, either father, mother or anybody, cannot make a will with respect to the 1/4 share of the daughter.
Okay, that is her right.
That is absolute.
Yeah, that's not
life in full interest, complete ownership. Now what father can do, even a daughter can do, with respect to the will, that today they have 1/4 share each in the subject matter property. Now they can very well execute a will not with respect to the whole of the property, but with respect to their only share.
Okay.
So even if a father execute a will, giving everything, even to a third person, it shall not affect the 1/4 share of the daughter.
Yeah, and it will not affect the 1/4 share of the
No, not at all. It can affect only
that 1/4 share of the father.
Father. He can give it to daughter, he can give it equally to all the children, he can give it to his wife also.
Okay.
Because wife is not in the class of one legal heir, neither she is a co-partner. So he may like to give it to his wife also.
Okay.
So, you see, what has actually happened, Dr. Kamal, that this journey of Hindu women getting equal rights in the matters of inheritance and succession as equal to that of a male. So this has been a long journey, because pre-1956 there was no legislation by which these rights were recognized. As I told you earlier, that there were different customary laws. Some of the popular customary laws were Mitakshra, Hindu law, Dayabhaga, the school of Hindu law, and they were prevailing in different regions. Like Dayabhaga was mainly prevailing in the regions of Bengal. Then in Kerala there was Nambudri.
Okay, yeah.
Hindu law, school of Hindu law,
so,
Nambudri.
So the daughter inherits the...
There were different procedures with regard to inheritance and succession amongst female heirs. But overall the rights of Hindu female were not recognized, they were discriminated and their rights were restricted in the family properties. And they were not considered to own in their own rights and to control in their own rights the properties. And it was only after the 1956 Act came, after the independence of our country, that Hindu Succession Act 1956 came. And this act had for the first time recognized the rights of Hindu female to own in her own name her properties, and how those properties will devolve upon her legal heirs after her death. But from 1956 to 2005, which is a long period of 49 years, there was still discrimination in case of a Hindu women in respect of joint Hindu family property. Because joint Hindu family property was always considered in the exclusive domain of male legal heirs. Because the co-partnery comprised of only male legal heirs, like a father, his son, grandson, great-grandson. But females never came in the co-partnery.
Yes.
Now only after the amendment in 2005, because our parliament had been considering these issues for a long time. And under the Constitution of India, Article 14, Article 15, there is equality between men and women. So it was to uphold the constitutional provisions and to give equal rights to women as that of men that these amendments were brought in the year 2005. And now with these amendments, we can say that majorly and substantially the rights of Hindu women have been brought at par with the rights of a son, a Hindu male, and they have been given parity in the matters of inheritance and succession, both in respect of self-owned, self-acquired properties as well as ancestral properties. So for all the people to understand, and particularly the women of our country, to understand that they have now equal rights, whether you are an unmarried daughter or a married daughter, you have equal rights in the matters of inheritance and succession as that of your brother in the properties of your father and his ancestors, or in the self-acquired properties if the father has not left behind a will.
Yeah, this is a great relief. That means the amendment in 2005 is a great relief.
Oh yes, undoubtedly.
And support for the
undoubtedly, undoubtedly. This had been a landmark amendment, and this has brought in major changes in the rights of women in the matters of inheritance and succession. So, women generally should now be aware about their rights, and they should be strong enough to independently deal with their rights and with their share in the properties, whatever have devolved upon them, and they can also execute their own will in the manner in they want to give their properties to their legal heirs as they desire.
Okay. So my appeal to the viewers that if you have got any queries on our subject, we are displaying our number also. You can send the query, or you can send the query even afterwards. If you have got some personal or any other important issues to be discussed, you can send it to us through e-Median Access, and we will take the opinion of our senior advocate, and we'll let you know what exactly has to be done. And what is the next subject?
So, will, I think we should tell about the will and how they can claim the right in the property if suppose the brother is not willing to give the share to his sister.
See, many times we come across problems where the will has been executed by the ancestor. Let's say the father has executed a will, and that will has been executed, let us say, in favor of the daughter. And the son also. But the son, who is the brother, he is not willing to give the share to his sister. Then the sister, being the daughter of her father, and when she has been given a right in the will, she can always take legal recourse, and she can always go to a court of law under legal advice and file a suit for partition against her brother, claiming her share in the property on the basis of the will left by her father in her favor. And in case her brother has any objection to the will, then he shall contest the case, and the daughter shall prove the will before the court of law under the legal provisions of Indian Succession Act and Indian Evidence Act. And if the court finally holds that the will has been validly executed, genuinely executed, then the court will pass decree in favor of the sister, giving her share in the property in terms of the will left by her father. So there are many cases like this, Dr. Kamath, which are pending in the courts today. And we have, by experience, found that these cases take lot of time in their decisions. So effort should be made on the part of all the people concerned, whether lawyers, whether judiciary, that such cases which relate to matters of inheritance and succession, which are pending for long number of years, they are also causing lot of mental stress to the people. And we have found that one generation, second generation, they are contesting these cases, and they take long number of years in their decisions. And once a court decides, then the matter goes to the appellate court, then from the appellate court it goes to the second appellate court, and these cases take a lot of time to decide. And during this period, lot of stress is caused to the family members who are involved in the legal disputes. So, effort should be made from all corners, and particularly lawyers should
more rights to the wife against the husband. Then the wife also has a right to claim maintenance against the husband under section 125 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. Then another law where wife has got right to claim maintenance against the husband is Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act. So there are these four acts: Hindu Marriage Act, Domestic Violence Act, Code of Criminal Procedure, and Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, where a wife has been given rights to claim maintenance against the husband in sufficient amount, adequate amount, depending upon their lifestyle, depending upon the facilities, depending upon the amenities, depending upon the income of the husband and what lifestyle they were used to living together. So wife has got these rights, but she has got no right to ask for partition in the property of the husband during the lifetime of the husband. That the wife does not have. Yes, if the husband has expired, then whatever share the wife gets in law under class 1 legal heir, Hindu Succession Act, that right and that share she can enforce in a suit for partition against the other family members of the husband if she is not being given her right in those properties. Suppose husband had a property and he had a property along with his father, joint or separate, and the husband has expired. Now the wife has equal share in that property after the death of the husband according to section 8, because wife is the class 1 legal heir being the widow. So now wife can claim her share in that property against her father-in-law, against her brother-in-laws, and she can bring a suit for partition in respect of her share, but not during the lifetime of the husband. During the lifetime of the husband, her only right is to claim maintenance.
No, but these days, most of the banks and agencies and even the organizations, they want to have nominations of the assets, whether it is fixed properties or movable properties or immovable properties.
Okay.
So even for the immovable properties, you need to have a nominee.
Okay.
Suppose there is a person, he has made his wife as his nominee, he has got two children, but he has not made the children as a nominee. He dies. What happens to that property? It will go to the wife only, or even the children can ask for that?
See, this is again a very, very important subject, Dr. Kamath. And till date, the law has been well settled that nomination is not succession. By nomination, it does not mean that the property devolves upon the person who is a nominee and the other legal heirs are deprived.
Okay.
Nomination is a responsibility.
Okay.
If father appoints one of his son as a nominee in respect of any movable property or any movable property, then the property ultimately, if there is no will, then it has to devolve by succession laws under the Hindu Succession Act upon all the legal heirs who are justified and entitled. And the person who is the nominee, it becomes rather his responsibility that he has to distribute the property amongst all the members. So nomination is not succession.
Okay.
Nomination is not inheritance. But recently I have to go through a judgment from Honorable Supreme Court where they have discussed some important aspects on this law of nomination, and maybe I'll be able to then say a little more.
So this holds true for those movable properties and
immovable, both
FDs,
bank checks, lockers,
okay,
jewelry,
all those things. Shares, bonds.
The benefit of the nomination is that suppose you have a bank account without a nominee, then you have to approach a court of succession to obtain a succession certificate for your own money lying in the bank. One side your husband has expired and now you have to move to the court to get your own money, and ultimately if you get it, you have to pay court fee from that amount also. So if there is a nomination, then straight away bank shall transfer the amount in your account. So that hurdle you cross. Then it's a liability in your hand. You cannot become owner of that property, be it a locker or a bank account, shares in demat account, even the insurance policy. In insurance policy, there are always nominee. But only because you are a nominee, you don't become owner of that amount in your hand. Everybody in succession class shall become the owner, but you cross the hurdle.
Only the nominee can execute the...
Yes, right. He is like an executor. It saves you from lot of
legal
hassles if you have a nominee in the records. So, but then nomination is not succession. It does not imply that the person whose name is mentioned as a nominee will get that property and become owner of it. Rather, it goes into his hands as a responsibility.
Yes.
To be distributed and divided amongst all the
Individuals. Because many times people keep on thinking while nominating whether they have to make their son as a nominee or a daughter as a nominee. But now it is clear that irrespective of who is the nominee, he is not the owner of that. He is only the executor. The person who has the right, he will get his right.
Unless that the legal heirs between themselves mutually and amicably and peacefully enter into a settlement, record a settlement, and they accept that whichever property is in the name of whosoever nominee will belong to him. And if they feel that there is equal distribution, because normally parents want equal distribution amongst their children.
Okay.
No parent would ever expect that after his death, their children may go in for any legal dispute. No parent, neither the father nor the mother. So they always try their best to distribute and divide their properties during their lifetime or in their will equally to all their children. But many times it happens that children, they don't feel satisfied with the arrangement made by their parents. So that's the cause why there are legal disputes and cases amongst those legal heirs.
Yeah, since we are almost coming to the end of this thing, would you like to add anything as far as this inheritance is concerned?
There are a lot of things to add. But broadly, today we have discussed the rights of female Hindu in the subject matter of inheritance. There are so many deep things, but I think that is sufficient for the day we have discussed.
It is clear that she has a right to.
I think all our viewers may have understood this subject a little more clear, and their understanding may become more clear. And if they have any queries, if they have any questions, they are most welcome to contact on the concerned numbers and the website, and we'll try our best to clarify their queries and their doubts. Thank you very much.
With this, we are coming to the end of this show. I thank Mr. Rahul Gupta, Ira Gupta and Shekhar Gupta.
Thank you
for sparing their valuable time.
Thank you very much.
Of their busy schedule.
Thank you very much.
And we have diverted from our regular medical topics this time. And if the viewers feel that we need to divert to some other topics like this once in a while, so please give us the suggest us the subjects like income tax, investments, and all other things. So we will be happy to organize for that. And next week, you will be able to view our webcast four days in a week, because next week we are starting the Perfect Health Mela organized by the Healthcare Foundation of India, and it will be for 4 days from 25th to 28th. and all the 5 days, 5 days from 25th to 29th, and all the 5 days we will be having the webcast between 3 to 4 on different subjects, and we will have great experts on that subject, and probably something new will also.